So with all this information, it sounds like gonorrhea and chlamydia are the same, but they aren't. So the latent or late stages of syphilis is very interesting because you could have it for years without knowing. For some people, it takes 10 to 30 years until they see symptoms. All right, and now we're moving on to our third category of STIs, which is viral. This includes herpes, HPV, and HIV. So I want to start with herpes, and the reason why is because 1 in 6 people in the United States have herpes. Many of those people have absolutely no idea that they have herpes. So herpes is transmitted through oral, anal, and frontal sex, but also if you touch the area. Now, usually herpes comes with sores, so you would imagine that you would just get transmitted if the person has an outbreak and sores and they touch you and then you have herpes. But that is a very big misconception because you can actually be infected with herpes if the individual does not have sores as well. The reason why a lot of people don't know that they have herpes, one, they don't get tested, but two, it mimics a lot of other types of, not diseases, but skin condition problems that we as humans have, like pimples and ingrown hairs. So with herpes, the main symptom is blisters. So these blisters, it could be one, it can be multiple in a cluster around the mouth, around the front hole, or the anus. And there are other parts of your bodies that can also get herpes. Now these blisters break and they turn into very painful sores that takes weeks to heal without medication. So other symptoms that herpes has is smelly discharge, painful urination, and if you are pre-T, you will be bleeding between the monthly thing that happens. So like I said, with herpes, you get these very painful sores. So when an individual gets their first herpes outbreak, they get these flu-like symptoms. So yeah, you get the sores, but you also get like the fever, you get like swollen lymph glands, and you get the muscle aches, everything that comes with having the flu. Now over the years, the outbreaks that you're gonna have will be reoccurring, but they will be less and less reoccurring throughout the years. But what individuals and people and everyone needs to understand is that once you have herpes, it will always be in your blood. So in order to get tested for herpes, you have to go to a doctor. I'm always gonna say that, you have to go to a doctor. All right, but the thing is, there is a really big misconception that I have learned is that you can only be tested for herpes if you have an outbreak. I had a very serious bladder infection a long time ago, and I had other infections that led to it, and one of the doctors thought that I had herpes, and he said, we can't test you because you don't have an outbreak. It absolutely made no sense to me, but I went around thinking that that's what it was like. Like, oh, you don't have an outbreak, you can't get tested, so I guess I don't have herpes, right? Wrong. You can get tested even if you don't have an outbreak. All right, so how do you treat herpes? Well, unfortunately, there is no cure for herpes, but there is medication that you can take that can help prevent or shorten the outbreaks that you have. And there is also a medication that you can take daily if you already have herpes to help with the reduction of transmission to a potential partner. So you can still have sex even if you have herpes. You just need to inform your partner and inform your partner of the risks, because even with a condom on, you can still transmit the herpes to your partner or partners. The reason for that is if you have sores, and they touch someone else, they can get it directly. It doesn't even have to be like an internal thing. It's the same thing for you. If you have sores on your mouth and you touch your mouth and you put your hand somewhere else right after you touch the sore, you will be moving your herpes somewhere else. So you will have herpes in two places. Like, we all know people who have cold sores, and that is part herpes, but that is just like oral herpes. What I'm talking about here is general herpes. I should have made that clear, but I'm sure that you got the point when I talked about like anal. So because herpes gives you these open sores, unfortunately, it makes the individual twice as likely to contract HIV. Moving on, so the second one is HPV. Now, HPV stands for human papillomavirus. This is the most common STI. Almost every single man and woman who is sexually active will get HPV at least once in their lifetime. That is very scary, and I did not know this before making this video. It is a very scary statistic. Now, the reason why it is so common is because it is transmitted through anal, oral, or front hole penetration even without symptoms, okay? So it's like herpes. You don't know you have it and you're giving it to people. So HPV is pretty scary because it can go away on its own, which is cool, but if it doesn't go on its own, you can develop genital warts and cancer. So genital warts can be small, they can be large, they can be raised, they can be flat, they can be cauliflower shaped. There's not one way that a genital wart is. So if you think you have genital warts, you should go. Now, the scary part about HPV is that if it's left untreated, it can eventually develop into cervical cancer and other types of cancers. So these other types of cancers are like vulva cancer, frontal cancer starts with a V, don't want to say it, don't want to cause dysphoria for anyone. Penis cancer, anus cancer, also throat cancer and tonsil cancer. So with the cancers that develop through untreated HPV, it takes decades for them to show up. And there's no way of knowing who will get cancer and who will not get cancer, because not everybody who has HPV that is untreated will get cancer. It has been researched that people with lower immune system and weaker immune system will develop cancer at a higher rate than people who don't. The reason why is because the immune system is not strong enough to fight off the HPV. So there is no test to know what your HPV status is, but they do have screenings for cervical cancer, but they are usually reserved for women who are over 30. Now I say women with the quotations because obviously I am including us in there, and the reason why is because we have this part. That's why I'm talking about HPV, because it's common and some trans guys might have it and never get a pap test, never want to get that area checked, and it's very dangerous. And I have made a video about the importance of pap tests, which I will link, but it's just to let you know that there are certain screenings that you can do, and if you are on hormones, you are not at more risk of developing cervical cancer or developing, if you have HPV, developing cancer because you're on T. Like, there is absolutely no link. There is research that is done about higher testosterone levels in women, and from what I have gathered, there is no correlation. So we've all heard of the vaccines that you can get to treat HPV. I am too old to have been in school when they were mandatory. But they were free if you were under 18, and now if you're over 18, you can get it until you're 26. And it comes in 3 doses, which you need to take over a 6-month period. So this vaccine helps prevent and fight certain strands of HPV, but not all of it. All right, so the last one that I'm gonna be talking about is HIV/AIDS. Now, HIV stands for human immunodeficiency virus. This is transmitted through some sexual contact and the use of needles or syringe. So there are a lot of misconceptions in society about HIV and people living with HIV, and it's usually brought on by the media. So hopefully I can shine some light on a couple of things and you can understand a little more. So HIV attacks the body's immune system, and more specifically the CD cells, and the CD cells are also known as the T cells, which help the body's immune system fight off infection. So if you contract HIV, your T cells lower, which means that your body is more prone to infection. So HIV is transmitted through blood, semen, precum, rectal, and frontal fluids, and breast milk. Now, when these fluids get in contact with the mucous membrane, so like the penis, mouth, and rectum, or if the fluids get in contact with damaged tissue on or in the body, or if it's injected directly into the bloodstream. So anal sex is actually the highest risk behavior, especially if you're a bottom. You can contract HIV through oral, but it is less likely unless you have like bleeding gums and you just like floss your teeth and then you're going to give someone a blowjob and they come in your mouth. Like, probably not the best idea to do that. So you cannot contract HIV through sweat unless it's mixed with blood, through saliva, unless you're like kissing passionately and you rip each other's gums when you're kissing and someone's bleeding, anything like that. You don't get HIV through hugging, the toilet seat, holding hands, nothing like that. So in order to know if you have HIV, you need to get tested. And there are 3 ways that you can do that. The first one is the standard blood test. Okay, it takes about 12 weeks for your body to develop antibodies against HIV. So this test that you would be having is the antibody screening test. That takes about a week to get the results. So the second one is rapid testing. Now this one is getting more popular because it's very easy to do. You just have to go in, they prick your finger, you put it on this, they put it in a little tube and they put it on this plastic thing and you get the results in like 2 minutes. Now with this, you can go 3 to 4 weeks after you think that you were infected with HIV. This is not 100% accurate though. Only about 90% of people develop enough antibodies for the test to pick up? Sure. So that means that if you test negative on that test, then you're fine. But if you test positive, you need to go get a standard blood test in order to make sure that the rapid testing was accurate. So the third one is one that I had never heard about before. It's one that you can take 12 days after you think that you were infected, but the results do take a bit longer. So before I talk about the treatment of HIV, I want to talk about the prevention of HIV. There are 2 amazing medications that have come out that everyone that I have talked to has literally no knowledge on. And I cannot believe this because these medications are changing the world. This is amazing. So what I'm talking about is PrEP and PEP. I think that's how you pronounce the second one, PEP. PEP? PEP? Sure. So what is PrEP? PrEP is pre-exposure prophylactic. It is a pill that you take every day, and it reduces your risk of getting infected by 90%. So it's not 100% accurate, so if you are having unprotected sex with someone who might be HIV positive, there is a percentage chance that you may become HIV positive, but this pill is 90% accurate, and that is better than what we had before. And can I just say how awesome that is? This is my personal opinion. I just think it's amazing that we do have that. So the second one is PEP, and PEP is a medication that you can actually take right after you think that you were infected. So you can take it within a 72-hour window. And it's a medication that, depending on the situation, the doctor will prescribe one or two pills to take every day for 28 days. Now, the medication that they're prescribing to you are antiretroviral meds, and that is the medication that they give to people who are HIV positive in order to treat them. So if you take it consistently for 28 days after you think that you might have been infected, you will not develop HIV. Now, there obviously is a small percentage that you may develop HIV, but the fact that there are medications that you can take that reduce that risk like crazy is amazing. So I don't know if you noticed the very large correlation, but it is very similar to birth control and Plan B. If you think about it, PrEP, you have to take a pill every single day in order to reduce your chances of being infected with HIV. Birth control, you have to take every day in order to reduce your chances of getting pregnant. PEP, you take after you think that you were infected for 28 days. Plan B, you take the pill after you think that you might have become pregnant. I'm not really sure how many pills you have to take. I think it's three. I'm not really sure though, so sorry about that. I should know that info. So how do you treat HIV? Well, you take antiretroviral medication every day, and if you are on top of your medication and you are able to take it every day, then your status becomes undetectable. This means that your risk of transmitting HIV to a potential partner or partners is very, very low. So you can't talk about HIV without talking about AIDS. Now, AIDS stands for Acquired Immunodeficiency Syndrome. So this is the late stage of HIV. If you are not able to take your antiretroviral medication every day, and you're not on top of it, or you don't have access to it, then the HIV that you have will develop eventually into AIDS. But please remember that not everybody who is HIV positive will get to the final stage of HIV and develop AIDS. If the person is able to access their antiretroviral medication every day and take it, they will not get to that stage. Now, AIDS is basically something that affects the immune system so badly that the body is now susceptible to something that is called opportunistic infections. So if you do get to the late stages of HIV and develop AIDS, and you are diagnosed with this, you have about 3 years to live. If you have an illness on top of that, because of the opportunistic infection that your body has been more susceptible to, you have about 1 year to live. And I'm going to reiterate something here, and probably later on and in other videos that I have, you do not die of AIDS. A lot of people say this, and this is one of the biggest misconceptions. I have heard people who have PhDs, people who are extremely smart, people who work with queer individuals and STI, people keep saying, you die of AIDS. He died from AIDS. Absolutely not. No, you die from complications from AIDS, and that's the opportunistic infections that your body is more susceptible to. That's what you die of. So example, pneumonia. So as I said before, AIDS is the final stage of HIV, and there are actually three stages. In the final stage, the individual will get mouth ulcers and flu-like symptoms, so fever, night chills, swollen lymph nodes, muscle pain, sore throat, fatigue, and all of those symptoms that are closely linked to the flu. So the second stage is the clinical latency stage, or also known as chronic HIV infection. In this stage, the HIV is active in the person's body, but it reproduces at a very low level. An individual who doesn't take antiretroviral medication can actually live with this for over 10 years without it ever changing and turning into late stage HIV, which is also known as AIDS. So the final stage of HIV is AIDS, and that's when an HIV positive is not on any medication. Their body's immune system weakens so much to the point where HIV turns into AIDS. So because the immune system is no longer able to fight off any infections, some of the symptoms that you get here are pneumonia, diarrhea that lasts more than a week, sores on the mouth, or genitals, There's also blotches that are about pink, purple, or brown that you can get on or in the skin that go on the eyelids and all around the skin. Extreme tiredness, hair loss, rapid weight gain, weight loss. All right, I'm done. Very sorry that this video was so long, but I'm not very sorry either because I wanted to say this information, so I made it long on purpose because this stuff is so important. I just want to raise awareness to make sure that everyone gets tested. We need to get tested. If you're sexually active, if you've ever been sexually active, if you think you have nothing, just go anyways. As you saw in this video, there are so many things like gonorrhea and chlamydia that don't show symptoms, and it's terrifying. It terrifies me. After doing all this research, I want to get tested like every week. I mean, I'm not having sex, but like, I'm just saying, it's scary, and it shows no symptoms. Come on, we need to raise awareness about getting tested. We need to raise awareness about talking about having an STI, because a lot of people do have STIs, and it happens. People are HIV positive, but a lot of people choose not to talk about it because it's so stigmatized in this society and in this community, and we just need to have an open conversation about it and not treat people who have STIs or are HIV positive like shit, because people are people, right? So hopefully this video helped a little bit. Thank you for sticking it out till the end if you did, and if you need any questions answered, go ahead and put them in the comments down there. I will also put the links of a lot of the information that I got. And hopefully you will watch more of my sex ed videos that will not be this long. This will be the longest one, don't worry. It took me about 2 hours to film this one. So have a great week. Thank you for watching. And again, thank you. Go get tested. Love you. Bye.